Hello, viewers. How are you doing? It's my pleasure on this day to bring on a very intelligent young man I just met in Brazilian by name Andrew Yu. He's going to say a little more about himself. And you've seen the caption, the title of what we want to talk about today in this brief chat, Contemporary Issues in Brazil and Beyond. Welcome.
Hello, Andrew. I'm Andre. Very pleased to meet you.
My pleasure. Tell our viewers more about yourself.
So my name is Andre. I was born in Brazil. My family is actually from Korea, but I was born and raised in Brazil. So it's very interesting to have a different ethnic background. Although Brazilian itself is very diverse, so I have people from many countries. Being brought up with an Asian culture, but being raised in Brazil, it gave me a better perspective on how to compare the different cultures, and in terms of weight, how much weight is given to certain aspects of life, like education or professional life.
Interesting, quite interesting. Like many of you out there will be. For your information, this chat will be on YouTube, Twitter. But at the moment we are on Facebook. We're going to download it to our YouTube channel, so you can watch it later, or you can invite your friends to see to the chat. This is very interesting in the sense, if you look at Andre, the first time I saw him, I said it's Korean or Japanese, except that many Japanese are a bit diminutive, if so to say. But he told me that he's Brazilian and he speaks Portuguese fluently. So it was a bit of an interest to me. Today we're going to talk about Brazil and beyond, because he's a bit cosmopolitan. We are in the Republic of Ireland. So let's start with Brazil. When were you born, and how do you bridge the Korean culture with the Brazilian culture?
So I would say that in the beginning, in my childhood, of course, I attended Korean schools in Brazil, as well as Brazilian schools, so I've always been exposed to these different cultures. And also at school, you have people from many different nationalities. Brazil, just like the United States or Canada, for example, even Ireland, is a very immigrant kind of country. So we have some native Brazilians, but they're not very numerous these days. So we are brought up with this basically hot pot of different nationalities. So that makes for an interesting experience from the very start of our life. My family being from Korea, of course, at home, we speak a mix of Portuguese and Korean. So it's very interesting to be brought up in a bilingual environment, and also with not just with the culture, but also with the cuisine. So these are things that shape your mind since a very early stage of your life. Especially in terms of education, there is a stereotype that Asian parents, in general, not everyone of course, they really push their kids very hard in terms of education. They're very strict and they only expect very high grades from them. So in a way that's bad, because it does create some stress for the children, but also they know that in the future professional life, this is something that can bring a lot of advantage.
Okay, and if you ask, do you know when your parents immigrated from Korea to Brazil? Do you have records of that?
Yeah, so my parents, when they were teenagers, they moved out from Korea to Brazil with my grandparents, of course. Just like any other immigrant, always look for a better life.
Yes, and Brazil is a very ethnic, diverse country. And will there be many people like you in Brazil?
People like me,
So
the vast majority of Asians in Brazil, they are of Japanese descent.
Really?
Probably numbering around 1.2 to 1.5 million people, directly and indirectly. So most of Japanese immigration happened over 100 years ago, especially until about 50 years ago. There are not many Koreans. It's a very small community. Being that the case, of course, some of us, we grew up within the community. So I didn't participate much, because I've always enjoyed more of that diverse environment. But some of us, of course, we grew up in a very traditional manner, even
now let's go to let's keep Daniel at the head, and that is Brazil. Brazil is a country of 209 million. It's a very large market, and I think the fourth biggest democracy in the world. And like we said, it's a multi ethnic diverse country. There are many things, rich resources, the Amazon rainforest, you know, a lot of people, many things continuing for Brazil. But unfortunately, there's still problems with Brazil, the issue of class divide. Some people call it class divide, others will say it's a racial divide. There's a big gap between the rich and the middle class. Then the people are the lowest rung of the societal ladder. And where do your parents belong? Are you of the middle class?
We're in the middle class, like the vast majority.
Okay.
Actually, I wouldn't say the vast majority would be middle class. We have a very large lower class population coming out of the economy. I've once read somewhere that what makes a country rich and fully developed is a very large middle class.
Exactly.
Right? Because the rich class, there will always be a rich class in any country. In any country, they will always be similar in the way they. if you're rich, you can have a nice life anywhere.
Yeah, exactly.
So the middle class, the small and medium-sized businesses, those are the ones that carry forward a country's economy. And unfortunately in Brazil, now tapping a little more into the economics of it. So in Brazil, it's very difficult to establish a new business.
Why is it difficult to establish a new business?
There is a lot of bureaucracy. And also there's a very high initial cost just because of import taxes, depending on the type of business you want to do.
Yes.
The real estate plus all the equipment that you need, if it's an industry-based corporation, for example, that takes a lot of initial investment, and it's very difficult for a lot of people to start a new business in Brazil.
Okay.
So we're very heavily service-based. Most people just end up getting employment somewhere instead of starting their own business. Like, for example, in the United States, there are much more medium small businesses because they make it very easy to set it up, especially in terms of taxation. They have very, very low taxation on loans, business loans, which is most people end up relying on those loans to start a new business. So I keep coming back to this business subject because in the end, it is really what carries a country forward. Is to have a large portion of the population with small and medium business and regularly employing people. Because if you only rely on large corporations and multinational companies, what happens in the case of Brazil now, of course, they usually hire more highly qualified people. Right? So in Brazil, it's actually sometimes difficult to find these professionals with the proper experience, with the proper qualifications. And that comes to the subject of education.
Okay, before you go further, I'm to ask you now, what's the most current problem in Brazil at the moment? What's hindering economic progress for most in Brazil? What would you say?
I wouldn't even say the current aspect because it's been stagnant for a long time. As you may or may not know, Brazil has been on an economic recession for many years now. And there has been a lot of news, international outlets about corruption. So the problem, I would say, if it relies a bit deeper, which would be in education. So we have this big deficit now in public education in Brazil. It used to be of a higher quality, maybe a few decades ago. But there's not much investment going, and professors, on average, their wages are very low compared to other developed countries.
Why?
It's just the level of importance that the government gives.
Attached to education. They don't attach much importance to education.
No. So when you go to public schools or public hospitals in Brazil, these professionals, they have very low pay. So of course, the service they provide is not going to be of best quality. That compares in contrast with the politicians, like senators or governors. They have very, very high salaries for what they do. If you look at the ratio of the salaries between politicians. very strong educational base. If the parents can afford it, they'll put them in a private school. But those are very, very expensive. And the vast majority of the middle class struggles a lot to put their children in such schools.
Okay. Now, looking at politics, we have a new president of Brazil.
Yes.
Bolsonaro, Jair Bolsonaro, just emerged from the Liberal Party.
Yes.
A lot of people have problems with him. It's like he has divided Brazil. Because I remember inauguration day, there was protests by the leftists because he's a far right man. He's made some statements before that contradict the present state Brazil has moved to on the issue of human rights, on the issue of racism, on women issues, and stuff like that. So a lot of people have issues with him. And do you think with this kind of president, there's going to be development? Even on the 3rd of January, just a few days after he came on, he used executive power to take back. There's an agency called FUNAI that is in charge of indigenous lands, and he just erased it and handed over the agency, land allocations to the Ministry of Agriculture. And a lot of people are beginning to question his presidency, that is going to divide Brazil more. What do you think about that?
Well, I will not tap too deeply into the politics of Brazil, because it's a very complex subject. Maybe you can find a lot of information about that online. But in my opinion, I would say the president in power in Brazil, traditionally, for most of history, it's been mostly on the populist side, the more the populist different parties. So what we can see now, maybe in the future, is a shift towards a more market oriented. So the subject we were talking about yesterday, the welfare programs. Now, and every country has some, almost every country has some kind of welfare program for the minorities or for the unemployed, which is commendable. Of course, we should always try to help those in need.
Yeah.
The issue is that when that becomes just a marketing campaign for re-election, and so many Brazilians, they share their that sentiment that sometimes the government will just try to, the party will just try to stay in power using those marketing tools with the people.
Okay, and from his statement, he said he wants to take Brazil out from socialism to what you said, maybe market-oriented economy. Because Lula da Silva, the Workers' Party, has always had socialist policies. But Brazil, let's agree that there has been corruption within the Workers' Party, because Lula da Silva was in prison, and he attempted to contest the presidency from prison, even against the decision of some of his contemporaries in the Workers' Party, until they brought in, is it Haddad to run against Bolsonaro. But looking at the history of Brazil, like you said, they're not investing much in education. A lot of people are still below the middle class category. How will they be raised up to join the middle class category, knowing fully well that a large middle class brings prosperity to a country?
So coming back to that point about politics, in the end, it really doesn't much matter. Well, at least it should not matter what party is in place. There should always be a focus in public services, especially given the very high taxes that Brazilians pay out of their income and the products they purchase on an import tax. So the Brazilian government, they receive a lot of tax regardless of who is in power. And so it's just a matter of using that tax wisely. Of course, that would involve a reduction in corruption. There has been a lot of progress in that in the past few years. Many corrupt politicians in some of them wrongly.
Sorry, when you say a reduction in corruption, how will what would be the modality be? How will they check corruption?
So the reduction can only come when you first recognize that there is a problem. Now, of course, it's a very common issue in Brazil that has been dragging the country for many decades. So for now, we have some progress in that. We just need more transparent taxation, more simplified taxation procedures. We have one of the most complicated taxation systems in the world, which again, it makes it very difficult for you to establish a business if you want to import machinery or if you want to export to other states, even to other states, not even international, you have to pay a lot of tax. So that always becomes a problem. Now, as you said, the educational issue. So there has to be a recognition that we need better public education, because the vast majority cannot afford a private education for their children. So in that, there has been some programs in the past governments to make schooling more standard and adapting the schooling to more international standards. So there has been some work being done on that, but still it's very slow. The problem with progress is it happens, but at a very slow pace. Also the issue comes with the public universities. They also need better funding, because I don't know if you know, but public universities in Brazil are free. Public higher education in Brazil is also free of charge.
But there's still issues. I wanted to come to that because you are happy more on education, and I see that you're very much interested in education. And like you said, education is very important. It's a ladder to climb up, you know, to the middle class, or even become rich. It can help you, especially to get into the middle class. But let us remember those in favelas. How will they access education? Because they are really below them. I looked at an issue on education in Brazil. I see that there's a new affirmative action for minorities in Brazil. But because, let's face the fact, 54% from statistics in Brazil are black population, but they're not educated. What's the cost of it? And how will they get up high in education? You are talking about quality education, and quality education needs funding, and the government is not bringing any funding into that. Then how will they get up to do that? Because Brazil, the way things are, the rich is holding on to power and is circulating among them. There are a lot of things to talk about. Just let me get your views on this.
So I would say, if you go to a Brazilian favela today, of course, proportionally speaking, there will be a much higher percentage of minorities.
Yes.
However, there will be, you know, first of all, different ethnicities being in the same economic, the same poverty level. So the issue in those places regarding education is more, there'll be more socioeconomic than purely racial or social in this case, in terms of social discrimination. Because again, that starts with access to education, right? So when you say the favelas, often what happens is there are too many students per classroom. There are not enough teachers.
Yes.
The teachers are not enough, are not well prepared. So if you want to improve the quality of education in the favelas, of course, you need to expand the schools. You need to hire more teachers, have smaller classrooms. There has been many psychological studies on how children acquire knowledge, and it's been confirmed many times that having too many students crammed in small classrooms, it only leads to chaos at those ages, rather than smaller classrooms like the ones you see.
Before we continue, viewers, I'm here with Andre, you a Brazilian of a Korean background. He was born in Brazil, and we are talking about contemporary issues in Brazil. He's more interested in education, but you've seen the title. I've added economics, racism, and other matters that may arise. I want you, you're a Brazilian. Can you explain to our viewers what this favela means, you know, the meaning of favela, who ends up in favela, you know. Just give a brief talk about this favela. The many of us don't understand what the meaning of favela and who ends up there.
So the general definition of what a Brazilian favela would be, you have this community of people with a lower level of income. I wouldn't say there's not a certain range.
Is it a ghetto?
It's not really a ghetto in the traditional sense. A favela usually will consist of poorly constructed houses, sometimes just...
Let's call it a ghetto.
That's not really a ghetto, because a ghetto is usually, mm-hmm. as from my understanding,
yeah.
you have, for example, New York City.
Yeah, you've been to America.
I live in America.
Oh, okay.
So you're gonna have like a ghetto. So within the city, within the city, there will be some rich neighborhoods,
yeah.
and there will be a ghetto, as you say.
Yeah.
But there are still houses built with a similar time or a similar standard as the other buildings nearby. So it's, when you say ghetto, as from my understanding, it's mostly about the region and for example, gentrification. So you have the level of income of people living in that region, but within a similar style of construction.
Yeah.
Right? Whereas in favelas, the construction will differ. You have very simple houses.
Okay.
There are no buildings.
No buildings.
There are almost no buildings in favelas. It's mostly houses, like one or two floors at the most.
So what's the house built with?
So the families that have very, very low income.
Yeah.
They don't even have access to basic building materials. So those houses we build sometimes with just roofing sheets or maybe plastic sheets, sometimes just plain wood sheets.
Yeah.
And the house, what would you call a house? Many families, however, they build bricks, so they'll just build on their own, brick and mortar houses. Sometimes they'll be painted as well. All the favelas, they differ a lot. So in Rio, we have favelas with a higher income level. They're very famous. So they'll differ according to the state, the region, and also within the city, they have different kinds of favelas. And also, often we don't like calling favelas, we call it communities, especially the people living in those areas. And often they will not have access to basic public services like sewage collection, garbage collection, electricity. It's a big problem, especially in my city, São Paulo, and Rio de Janeiro, the big cities. There are too many people living in the favelas, and they don't have access or they can't afford electricity. So they'll often just improvise pulling wires directly from the electricity poles, but that causes fires.
Yeah.
And those fires are very deadly.
Yeah.
Because there will be like a total devastation of these favelas. I've seen it myself.
Who owns the land in which these shanties are built?
So most of the time that will be public land. Often, as you see on TV and the movies, it would be on the hillsides, where private real estate companies will not usually be interested in having buildings in such areas. So there would just be forested areas. And people gradually move in as the city sprawls, people expand. And those regions are very far away from city center with very poor access for transportation, for example.
Okay.
So people living in those communities, they'll often spend on average 2 or 3 or maybe 4 hours a day just getting themselves to work and coming back. It's
really?
A very difficult
really?
Life. Yes.
How?
Because
transportation or what? Is it all the city?
They're still within city limits.
And how is it? How do they take up to 2-3 hours?
Sometimes they have to take 2 or 3 buses to get to work. They have to walk a very long distance. Yes, because there will be very poor bus access.
Okay.
You can pretty much forget about subways. In very few cases, subway lines will reach as far as the favela areas. Yes.
Is it a calculated aim by the government to ostracize them from having access to infrastructures in the country, or what?
The government will sometimes take action. I've been through many favelas myself. I have many friends from those communities, and seeing the way they live. Actually, they have, many of them have decent lives. They have decent houses. It might not look very nice on the outside sometimes, but when you go inside, of course, people want to have a nice quality of life, even no matter what their income.
Okay.
But again, when it comes to working, they usually have jobs in the city. They'll try to get jobs in the city center that pay more. But then that comes at the cost of time. They have to spend a lot of time commuting back and forth to their jobs.
Okay. Are there many cases of people moving up the category from being favela dwellers to dwellers in rich suburbs?
That is very difficult to happen. Right? So of course it does happen. It depends a lot on your personal effort, on your upbringing. If your family was able to afford you a better education, you can get even a good university in Brazil. It's very difficult to get because there are not many open spots for students.
Yeah.
So a lot of people have to compete for very few positions in your public universities.
Yeah.
It's again because of funding. So you have many public universities, but you just don't have enough room for everyone trying to get into those public universities.
Yeah.
They're already, one of the classrooms I've been to, there were 70 people in one classroom. And of course, you would question the quality of education in those cases. The government says they don't have enough funding for hiring more professors, to give them higher wages. Many of them are actually in the university to do research primarily, and teaching will be their secondary function. But in any way, to get into those public universities, and hence being able to get a better job opportunities after that, it requires for you to take an entrance exam. Those entrance exams are very difficult to pass. Maybe not their basic difficulty level, because they're highly competitive. Of course, if the public education is free, everyone's gonna try to get into those schools.
Okay, there's this question that have always bugged me, and I see that among Brazilians, because Africa World newspaper was, when I established it, it was with help from many Brazilians. Many of them went back when the recession came in Ireland. Many will watch this, they will be interested to look at this. The Brazilians seem not to be comfortable talking about racism. Mm. And I noticed that. And I've seen documentaries on Brazil. I don't know if you know the history of your country. Brazil was built on the back of racism.
Yes, slavery.
Slavery. Brazil ended slavery in 1888, 20 years after the United States of America.
Yes.
And they are not comfortable. Instead, they will bring a pseudonym on. It's a class issue, you know, like you are talking now, the education issue. I know it's an education problem, but why are Brazilians not comfortable to call the spade a spade?
I'm not exactly sure what people have told you about it. Maybe some of
the shy away from
the shy away. Maybe they don't have enough knowledge about it. I'm not an expert on the subject either, so I can only give my personal opinion on my observations.
Yeah.
So since the times of the slavery, in Brazil, like we just talked about, it's very difficult for you to get out of your social condition,
yes,
unless you're lucky enough to have that. You have to either push yourself,
yes,
away from that vicious circle,
yes,
or you will have to be lucky enough to be born in a family that can afford you that education. And I keep repeating education. Why? Because of course, if you want to be a successful professional, in this case Brazil, or pretty much any other country, you usually have one of two ways. You would become a liberal professional, like an artist or a lawyer or a doctor, or you try to get a job in a big corporation, or you start your business.
Yeah.
Right. But in either way, you're gonna need knowledge to get there.
Yes.
Maybe not so much to build your own business. You just have a really good idea and funding. But like I said, the barrier to starting a business in Brazil is very high. So most Brazilians, kids end up looking for traditional jobs in the job market. That makes the job market very competitive, especially for higher paying jobs. Those that can get you out of all the vicious circle of poverty.
Okay, you really hammered on this, and I am beginning to see maybe that's why there are many Brazilians immigrating out of the country. Why is it difficult to start up, to be an entrepreneur, a small-scale entrepreneur in Brazil? Why is it difficult to start a small business? Is it a taxation issue, or raw materials, or why?
Yeah, it has to do with all these topics, as we talked before. If you have a lot of initial capital for available for investment, it would not be a difficult thing to do. But just getting to start your own business, especially if it's a big city, right? So the real estate is very expensive. It's overpriced, especially in Rio and São Paulo, the big cities.
What about Brasilia?
Brasilia, it's of course the capital of Brazil. It is a large city. It's actually it's pretty well developed. There will be poor areas as well.
Yeah.
But in terms of job market, it's not where the most opportunities would be, especially given the geographical location in the middle of Brazil. It's very far away from the ports. It's very far away from natural resources.
Yeah.
But being the political center, of course, it has its importance. Also, as a transportation hub, in the heart of Brazil, many flights pass by Brazilian airport.
Yeah.
But that would only benefit those who work at the airport.
So how would you assess Bolsonaro, Jair Bolsonaro? How would you assess knowing his antecedents? I know he wants to move the country from socialism into a capitalist system, which Brazil, the right wing or elite class, is comfortable with, far from the Lula da Silva and the Rousseff era. How would you assess? Do you think a Jair Bolsonaro regime is going to do well for young Brazilians like him?
I don't think there can be a miracle from any specific party or any specific president. What I believe always is that it's in moderation. So if you have an extreme leftist or an extreme right wing party, and they take such extreme actions, it's probably not going to go well, because you always need a balance. You have to think in a very rational way in the end, especially in terms of those internal and external policies. So Brazil has always been an export heavy country, especially with basic commodities like grains, or we even export essentially like minerals and agriculture, right? But if you want to make your country have a big leap, economically speaking, you want to develop your own technology, right? That's what happens in industrialized countries like the United States or Germany, or Europe in general, Korea, Japan, the same thing. Again, coming back to the topic of education, another reason why that is important is that because if you want to develop in-house technologies, if you want to make your country be more industrialized, rather than relying heavily on companies from other countries setting up business in Brazil, setting up their factories and industries,
you want to
have your own people
starting
your own high technology companies and hiring people in Brazil domestically. I think it would be a very long way for us to get to this position. This kind of a development, it depends a lot on how well the government can finance these startups, which unfortunately we don't do very well. There's not much investment research in Brazil, as much as it should be, proportionally to how much income they have from taxes, and proportionally to the size of our population. So Brazil has a huge potential to become a powerhouse on the global scene. But like we said, you need more people studying engineering, for example, engineering or medicine, if you want these industries to go forward, rather than relying on, like in recent times, you were importing doctors. population size of over 200 million, there should be no problem for us to find domestically all the highly qualified professionals we need. We just don't have enough of them. For example,
What's the cause? Why are the elites hell-bent on importing doctors from neighboring countries instead of funding medical schools?
Yes, exactly. So the medical schools in Brazil, the public ones, are heavily underfunded. In the past 10 years, there has been constant strikes from the professionals working in those universities. A big part of the equipment used by the students are outdated, they're old, and there's just, like I said, there's not enough spots for all the people trying to get into medical schools. So it becomes something very competitive and very stressful. I know friends who've been trying to get into medical school in Brazil for years, and they're just not able to because the entrance exam is too difficult, because there are not enough spots for everyone. So again, it's something that the government has to give more attention to.
Okay, that's interesting. Now, I want us to look a bit on crime. Brazilian, you're Brazilian, you know, just issues about crime that keep resonating from Brazil. A lot of people say you are not safe as a tourist or as a visitor in Brazil. Some parts of major tourist cities, you can't even walk with your phone on the streets. You could be hijacked, or if you are of mixed race, or if you are black, there are some places you may be gunned down by the police and things like that. What's the issue about crime in Brazil?
So of course the international media outlets, or even our own media outlets, will greatly exaggerate how bad the situation is. We do have a very grave problem with criminality, but not so enough that should not hurt tourism that much. So Brazil is very famous for its nature and the beaches. Not just Rio, but the country in general. So we have a potentially very high, we could have a very high income with tourism, much more than we have today. But I personally know a lot of people who shy away from traveling to Brazil because of this criminality issues.
Yes.
It's a very complex issue to solve. It has to do a lot with education and economics. You can only get these people out of these criminal organizations or just committing petty crimes if they're giving them the opportunity for a better life. But it's very difficult for them because of the vicious circle. If you're born in a poor family, you're probably bound to stay forever in that cycle, unless your parents can afford private education or you can have some kind of business idea, but it's generally very hard to get into that out of the system. So many of those teenagers, they end up getting into the crime world.
Okay, and there's a statistic I got from University of São Carlos. It says that 58% of people killed in the state of São Paulo by the military police are blacks. And there's an issue in a place called Lagartixa.
Yeah, it means lizard.
Yeah, in which, what does it mean?
Lizard. Yeah.
Okay, Lagartixa. Okay, in which five teenagers were just gunned down by military police because of they were celebrating their first paycheck on a Sunday, although the police were arrested. I had to assess that news and saw that why do the police just shoot people indiscriminately like that?
So that's a very big social issue. Unfortunately, as we talked about, the problem that has been dragging since the times of slavery, and it's been very difficult for people to get out of the vicious circle. That has been a bit more success in that sense with the slaves that live in America, in the United States, just because of the way the country was colonized and the way the government will take action, especially with public education. Of course, in the United States, much better than Brazil. Still, still not at the European level probably. But more, I have many African American friends when for the time I was living there, and I see a lot, high proportion of them being able to get into good universities and get good professional positions later in life, much more in Brazil, proportionally speaking.
Yes.
Why? It's much harder to get out of the vicious circle in Brazil.
Why?
Because of the access to quality education. So
it's not easy to access quality education in Brazil.
When you look at the private schools that are very expensive, there'll always be some minorities, some students of color, but it's a very, very tiny fraction. It's very hard to see that. Just because their parents, they don't usually have the income level, the jobs that can provide the income for them to provide that kind of education to their children. If they could, that would change everything. So again, it's that kind of problem. And so what happens is you have a cascade effect.
Yeah.
Because these minorities, a lot of them live in the favelas and the poor communities, they end up getting into crime.
Yes.
Because that ends up being their only way out, their only way to make a living is to get into crime. So there will be a much higher proportion of these minorities getting into the crime. So the police, of course, they will tend to think, they will just wrongly assume that just because you're a person of color, you're going to be a criminal, which is, of course, totally wrong. It's a very bad racist problem. Also happens in the United States, maybe to a lesser degree here in Europe. But that ends up being a problem, like you said. Innocent people end up being shot or jailed because they end up, you know, in that whole mess of the criminality in the poor areas.
And frankly speaking, how do you think this issue can be solved?
Well, as we said before,
I know how would you, frankly speaking, being a Brazilian, growing up there, understanding the favelas and the Afro-Brazilians, their predicaments. How would you think, looking at it pragmatically, how would the issue be solved?
So pragmatically, first of all, if you want to get people out of that vicious circle in the favelas, you need to give them very good access to public services, right? So first of all, you need to improve their quality of life in basic terms. So access to quality food, access to sanitation, so people don't get diseases that are easily spread in those areas, which means also access to decent public health, public hospitals. You don't have to get, for example, in very long wait lines, which usually happens in public hospitals, public schools. So you need, first of all, access to those things. Also, for our young population, you need to give them access to quality like sport facilities, for example, because we all know a way out of the criminal world and out of the drugs is to give these children more options in terms of not only schooling, but what do they do after school? Because obviously, you're gonna do something with your free time. So when you have too much free time and you don't have access to how to use that free time in a productive way, be it either in sports or learning languages or learning instruments, or just learning something outside of the school environment, like it happens very, very well here in Europe, for example. So a way to keep the kids out of the streets and out of the drug gangs would be this access to what you say, education and entertainment outside of school.
Okay,
that needs a lot of funding.
Yeah.
Right? That needs millions and billions of investments. The government has that money.
But that
money drains out in corruption and just very bad public spending in general.
Do you think Bolsonaro is going to end corruption in Brazil? Is it possible?
It's a very simple answer to that. Nobody can single-handedly end corruption.
Yeah, but to a
there has to be a general shift in the whole politics structure in Brazil.
But can he do that? Look at his cabinet. He just appointed seven of his classmates when he was in the army as ministers, because they are cabinet members. He was a former army captain, and he lost, in fact, he